I'll take you in the next 25 minutes of how we need to really look at fever. I think most of the times the parents feel that the fever is a curse, and for some reason or the other, therefore, a pediatrician is expected to bring down this temperature instantly if possible. We should not forget that fever really enhances immunity, and therefore fever is certainly beneficial. Everything that is beneficial could be harmful, but in prima facie, the fever is really beneficial, and to that extent, we need to realize how much we need to suppress each time we met fever. We know that fever has been mostly a friend, and there is enough literature support right from ancient time when we know that fever is protective, it inhibits pathogens. We know that there is a higher survival rate in febrile septic patients than hypothermic patients. We know that pre-antibiotic era, a disease like neurosyphilis was treated by inducing fever. And finally, to a clinician, a fever pattern is a clue to diagnosis and may be blunted by potent antipyretic, which often causes delay in the correct diagnosis. Look at the yesteryear's physicians who could talk of fever as remittent, continuous, intermittent. Now every fever is a non-existing fever. You give a paracetamol or even more powerful antipyretic and the patients have no fever. What kind of approach we have when the patient's fever is totally blunted? And I think, to me as a clinician, when a child is running fever, it gives me a definite clue to a pattern of fever that probably would be very useful for a rational approach. But then, can fever be really a foe? Yes, it could be. If you have a hyperpyrexia, then fever may induce simple febrile seizure. We know generally it's a benign condition, and not every child who has high fever really gets into a simple febrile seizure. And neurologists tell me now that even if somebody gets a simple febrile seizure, next time you keep the parents busy with controlling fever, but that's not a guarantee against a simple febrile seizure. Quite a complicated issue in a simple febrile seizure. We need to tell the parents that keep them busy reducing fever. Well, fever may worsen or manifest a pre-existing condition. I'm sure that you have a very sick child in an ICU, that fever might add on an extra burden to his metabolic problems. But to me, fever represents an occult serious disease, and we know that fever does result in increased water needs, and if not anything, it certainly causes discomfort. So now, knowing that fever is very useful, is beneficial, it enhances immunity, but rarely it may cause some more trouble, let's see whether should fever be suppressed. I think fever is beneficial, but beyond certain limit may be discomforting or even harmful. I tell the parents of children whom I see with fever that if it is around 102 or less, it is beneficial and it often causes no discomfort. Most of the mothers would tell you that the child is running about in spite of fever. In fact, that behavior of a child makes me as a clinician to understand that very likely the cause of fever is not serious. On the other hand, you may have had mothers who come and tell you that, doctor, the fever is not much, but the child is rather dull, apathetic, drowsy. Now that bothers me much more. Therefore, within limits, this is not to be worried about. If the fever is going higher, it's still beneficial, as we said it is, but it could be causing discomfort. And therefore, what do you treat this fever? Take away discomfort, but not take away fever. And I think unless we counsel parents to say, each time I see a child with fever and the parents ask me how long it's going to take, we need to kind of counsel them and say that it will take its own course, especially if it's a viral infection. And each time they say that you give paracetamol for 4 hours, the child is all right, he gets fever again, which certainly means that there is a infection which is still lurking. And I think it's when the parents expect something miraculous and we fall prey to their demands, trying to really meet their demands, that we get into trouble on a rational approach. I'm sure a millionaire who suffers from a fracture still sits in a plaster for 2-3 months. Same thing with a poor person. No millionaire asks an orthopedic surgeon to set his fracture right in a shorter time, maybe with an imported plaster. That doesn't help. And I think it's up to us to counsel the parents. And once we know that the fever is not damaging, I think the confidence that we exude to tell the parents, almost always the parents would follow. But if fever is going higher, then surely it may cause harm, in which case you certainly want to control fever to comfort and safe level. How do you do that? Certainly use an antipyretic, we know that. And besides that, we use the supportive measures. I'm sure all over the country, the moment the child has fever, parents cover him much, much more to prevent pneumonia or whatever. And when you're feeling cold, you also take a blanket. When you tell an educated parent that why do you have a blanket for both situations? When you feel cold, you have a blanket. When your child is feeling hot with fever, you still use a blanket. Therefore, many such actions which are probably a cultural add-on to having a poor response to an antipyretic. And I think that's the time the parents say that the antipyretic is not working. Surely the lukewarm water sponge. Gone are the days when you put something on the forehead. That used to only announce an ideal antipyretic. I think unnecessary there have been debates in our country. Just because we feel antipyretic is against fever. So fever must come down. We know that a painkiller never kills pain. It makes the pain tolerable. Even then it is called painkiller. Antipyretic is one that does not bring down fever to normal and should not bring down fever to normal, but it should make the fever comfortable and safe. Unless we put this across to the parent, parent expect that the temperature should crash down to normal. To that, I think we need a short-acting drug. There is no point in having a drug which acts for 12 hours when the fever may not come again after one episode. You need therefore a short-acting drug so that we can repeat the dose as many times as you want. Efficacy, as I said, reduction of fever to normal is not ideal. You have a paracetamol which is a time-tested antipyretic, and I almost never use anything else because I feel if the paracetamol does not work, only two conditions. One, either it's not given properly in an adequate dose, or the condition causing fever is serious enough. And I think both ways you are quite forewarned that there's something else you need to look at. On the other hand, if you just crash down fever with nice drugs, then I think you will miss many things. And as a pediatrician, it's not nice to see a pneumonia coming without fever. Mahesh Babu said, no fever is no pneumonia, bacterial pneumonia. But I see in my practice, pneumonia bacterial without fever. Because nicer things are available and you can bring down fever but not pneumonia. Okay, the textbooks need to be rewritten that you have in India a pneumonia without fever. And therefore, I think it's important that we use a drug like paracetamol, and we know that this is very ideal, we will not go by that, but the best part is it could be used at any age, almost in any situation. What about other antipyretics? Well, I think ibuprofen is a useful alternative. WHO has considered it as good as paracetamol. I think in children it's not much of a problem of gastric irritation, and one might use this as well. But I think the other ones, including nimesulide, I think should be thrown out. I'm very sure I forecast that it will have a natural death very soon, but not before probably some kidneys or livers are damaged and some pneumonias and meningitis are missed. There is no reason to use such an antipyretic at all, and this is not an antipyretic. Having said that, we know that we manage fever symptomatically, but what about the cause? You need to tell the parents that fever never kills, but it's the disease causing fever that may kill. And I think having decided how to control fever, we need to go next step to say, what's the cause of fever? You may have very low-grade fever and the child may die. On the other hand, it's not higher the fever, the child has a higher mortality. The parents generally consider serious illness proportionate to a degree of fever. And you and me know that if a child is immunologically very potent, he is likely to throw up a high fever, and that is nothing really to worry about. How do I go in my clinical practice? As soon as I see a patient with fever, I need to anticipate seriousness for immediate referral. And I want to know whether this child needs to be referred right away or I hold back. If not serious, then I judge the probable cause. If the child has a serious problem, I don't think I need to waste time in deciding the probable cause. If we find that there is a probable cause that is evident, confirm if possible and treat. And we will see at each point of time when you confirm ideally. No cause is found, then a symptomatic treatment with close observation for 3 or 4 days, because you already got out of a serious illness. There is no hurry. And if there is no clue at the end of 3-4 days, then you order tests and then treat empirically, but not before you have ordered some tests. And if at the end of all that, if the fever persists, then you may have to refer to a specialist, not because he understands anything better than you, but you need to prove to the parent that he also is as bad as you are. So take that help, because I'm sure all of us know the same medicine. Who is better? Nobody is better. But I'm sure that as a senior pediatrician, we are at advantage. When I see a patient after 1 month of fever, 3 pediatricians having made enough mistakes, there is no more mistake left for me to create. And the parents feel that, oh, this man knows very well. So they said, next time when he starts fever, I'll come to you. I said, no, don't be in a hurry. You come a little later. So that is, I think, how we go about. Let's see how we anticipate seriousness. I think age under 3 months high fever is serious, because you just cannot wait on, it's risky. You cannot write an antibiotic at all. You need to probably quickly. Yes, if you are a very confident clinician, you will see a viral infection even under 3 months. And you need to be very, very confident. You need to have a mother or another sibling having a viral infection. This child is breastfed, he is feeding well, he is behaving well, and he has a fever, cold, cough. You might call it a viral, but it's risky. Of course, change in behavior. What do you want to know for immediate referral? Under 3 months, meningitis, pneumonia, sepsis, inflammatory abdomen, diphtheria. I feel there is no another cause that will kill the child even if you wait for the next 3-4 days without a diagnosis. But the child will be dead if you started a drug without knowing the diagnosis. And I think I'm sure that Dr. Vijay Kumar will agree that UTI can wait for 2 days, but don't harm by giving an antibiotic on day one. But a meningitis, pneumonia, sepsis, inflammatory abdomen, of course, surgical abdomen, guarding rigidity, etc. And a diphtheria, which I'm told is kind of resurging back in some pockets, need to be very, very carefully assessed. So what do I do in the first day of fever when I see a child? I just say that I have nothing of this, and in which case, I try to now judge probable cause. Fever is acute infection, till proved otherwise. What does it mean? There is no acute infection without fever. Chronic infections, of course, can come without fever, we know that. The pattern of fever tells me mostly. To me, episodic, unrelated to antipyretic, is malaria. Now, we all know that malaria in newborn is without fever, only hepatosplenomegaly. Malaria in infant could be a low-grade continuous fever, yes. But I think in general, you would have some erratic fever. Onset and progression is very important. A typical bacterial infection peaks by day 3, day 4, unless it is a pus-producing infection like a tonsillitis, where you have a high fever on day 1. But look at the viral infection, generally a high at onset, and in fact declining by 3-4 days. And therefore, as a simple rule, I am sure that those of you who are very wise know too many exceptions. It's nice sometimes not to be very wise and very well informed. Then you follow the rule. 99% you are all right. And therefore, this is the rule. For me, a typhoid starts with gradual peaking by day 3, day 4, and I anticipate it by day 3, day 4, the fellow should be better. So to me, as a clinician in my office practice, I can almost differentiate viral from bacterial. Viral is upper lower airway, disseminated, and the bacterial is localized. I think even if we just go by that, we are almost always correct. What's the clinical evidence of a definite bacterial infection? Very rare. And therefore, you will not write an antibiotic in the first 2-3 days of any fever. Because unless you met a definite tonsillopharyngitis or an otitis, for an otitis, you need an otoscopic examination. Otherwise, you will diagnose even when the grandmother can diagnose. That means the pus flows out. And therefore, this is, I'm sure, I hope none of you wonder what is this new scope. bacillary dysentery. If I see a high fever with blood and mucus, I would give an antibiotic. If I have an acute lymphadenitis, painful acute high fever, I need not wait for any test. But look at this. Except this, probably a UTI in an older child that I can pick up. And I quickly ask for a routine urine and then get on to an antibiotic. How often you meet this? Definitely. I think in a smaller child you hardly meet this. And therefore the rule would be no antibiotic in the first 2-3 days, especially if you have no seriousness. It will confirm. I think UTI is a must confirmation. We have had an excellent talk about that. Dysentery, it may be ideal to confirm, but I'm not worried because amoebiasis is rare in young children. So there is no need to use broad spectrum with all kinds of things together. It's a bacterial infection. Well, the confirmation is optional in URTI. If I see a tonsillitis, what confirmation? If I see a lymphadenitis acute, what confirmation? But barring this, there is hardly any reason to start an antibiotic. So we have already said when to treat. Symptomatic treatment, we have already discussed. Now I have a child at the end of 3-4 days, no clue at all. Now I start looking at. Mahesh will agree with me that in an infant I would ask for a chest x-ray on day 4, because I'm not too good a clinician to pick up a small pneumonia that might be in trouble. Well, you might look at CBC. I will just again highlight that this is very important. These are useless. Platelets are important. And we have learned how eosinopenia may be very useful. You may have a high neutrophilic leukocytosis in a systemic inflammatory. You have a neutrophilic leukocytosis even in an acute viral infection. We heard in typhoid you may not have leukopenia. So what does the count tell you? Very little. But maybe the eosinophils might tell you something much more. What empirical therapy you want to give? I'll talk about the empirical antibiotic therapy. But if I'm not sure, in my epidemiology, chloroquine is a reasonable bet. But antibiotics based on, we have discussed how to choose an antibiotic. If the fever persists beyond 4-5 days and there is no clue whatsoever, I don't think any one of us is wiser. I just want to make a point that I don't do ESR very often. Especially in the first week, ESR has no use at all. Once I told an undergraduate that ESR is high even in common cold. They said, which textbook has given? I said, in textbooks they don't expect you to do ESR in common cold. That's why they haven't said it. It's too much to do it in common cold. Point is that in summary, you have a fever as a desirable protective response. It's harmful to suppress it completely. Fever never kills, except hyperpyrexia maybe. What may kill is the cause of fever. Hurry to diagnose probable cause rather than treat empirically. And I think you need to be in a hurry. And many times parents tell me that you ask me to observe, why don't you act? And action without justification is harmful. And I think we need to tell them that. Finally, when they don't understand, I tell them that you need a better doctor. Then they are confused. They can't ask me who is a better doctor. If they look confused, I tell them, if you find one, please tell me. The next patient can be guided. Thank you very much.